welcome back to our seminar after a 2 weeks break, I think, or weeks break. Today we're happy to have with us Dr. Inbal Benami Bartal. Inbal is the head of the prosocial behavior lab at Tel Aviv University in the School of Psychology Sciences and the Sagol School for Neuroscience, and she's also an Israeli faculty fellow. She received her PhD from the University of Chicago and then did a postdoc at UC Berkeley. Now she's the head of the Nobel Center in the physics department. And today we're going to hear about how social identity, group identity, is encoded in the brain, and how that affects the interaction between individuals. Thank you, for being.
Thank you, Yonatan, for that lovely introduction, and thank you all so much for coming to my talk. I'm excited to tell you about what our lab has been doing. I'll tell you some of the work that I previously did and some of the newer work that we've been doing in the lab here in Tel Aviv. So for the topic that we're most coming, don't be embarrassed. The topic that I'm most interested in is empathy. And when I'm talking about empathy, what I'm really referring to is this ability that we have to naturally understand other people's emotions, affective states, and to mirror those states, to be emotionally engaged. And when we talk about empathy, it's not only this emotional contagion, right? When we talk about empathy, we're also assuming some kind of pro-social motivational states, this intention to improve the well-being of the other individual or to reduce their suffering or their distress, in case that we're talking about empathy for distress. So in the field of psychology for a long time, the main idea is that empathy is a major driving factor for pro-social behavior, pro-social actions that are actually intended to improve the well-being of others, like helping behavior that we're studying. And actually, I'm not quite sure. I definitely was educated to think that this is the process, but I'm not so sure anymore. So maybe we'll get to that towards the end. So what my lab is focusing on is trying to understand what happens in the brain when we see someone in distress, how we interpret those distress signals, and how that motivates this pro-social approach to behavior. And not only that, but we're also interested in the question of identity, as Yonatan mentioned. We don't care in the same way about anybody. The social identity of the person in distress is really important towards determining the entire cascade of emotional, motivational responses that we experience to that distress. So the social categorization of identity and how that influences pro-social motivation and empathy is also one of the major questions that we're looking into. And we're relying very much on relatively recent developmental ideas in the field of psychology that is a paradigm shift from viewing empathy and compassion as something that's uniquely human, that's divine or kind of the religious, what sets us apart from other animals, right? Like animals are selfish and humans learn to share, to care, and respect about others. And there was a paradigm shift that started to understand that actually empathy and pro-social behavior existed, they're ubiquitous throughout social mammals for sure, and any animal that actually has to raise its offspring of social mammals. And the mechanisms, the biological mechanisms that bring about this kind of responses to other work with rats. A lot of people work with mice. And rats are incredibly precocious. They're very cute. They're very social. So it's kind of a, and their capacity to learn complex behaviors is really impressive. So we focus on rats, and the approach of the lab overall is a systems approach, okay? So what does that mean? It means that we're really interested in understanding, combining these different perspectives, the behavioral perspective, and the neuronal as well as the peripheral responses to understand how complex behavior occurs, really. It's a very wide view, but we're trying to combine that with specific molecular mechanisms from cellular to network. And the paradigm that we use in the lab is called the helping behavior test. It's a paradigm that I developed during my PhD, and basically it's very simple, low-tech design. One rat is trapped inside the restrainer, and another rat is able, if they choose to do so, to open the restrainer and release the trapped rat. And this is a paradigm that repeats daily over a couple of weeks, and what we see after a few days of testing, that rats tested with their cage mates learn to open the restrainer, and once they learn how to do that, they do it very quickly in subsequent sessions, and for the most part, most rats typically learn to open the restrainer and release their trapped cage mates. They don't do that for other control conditions, and this is what it looks like. Some of you have maybe seen this. This is the fifth day of testing when the rat on the outside, on the 25th minute of the session, realizes for the first time how to open the freaking door that he's been trying to open along this day of testing.
Flipping down the weight from the side. So that's what we call a separate
who demonstrated the same principle with modified paradigms. So in this paradigm, they press a lever to let the other guy out of a pool of water by Cox and Rachel. And in this, by Sato et al., the Japanese group, they have a bunch of papers. And in their paradigm also, the rat releases another rat from a pool of water, but they don't have any interaction after the release behavior. So, yeah.
On the graph, you plot median latency to open, and you said there's increased probability. So
right. So the latency to opening is how long it takes them to open the door. So basically, the lower it is, the faster they're opening the door. Okay. So.
Will they always open? Because you say probability of opening.
The probability of door opening for the same rat on the next day. Once he figures it out, there's a very high probability that he will do it again.
And what is it? Latency. What is it?
Latency
second
means how long. Yes.
What are the units?
Here, the units is minutes. So
minutes.
40 basically is the end of the session. Okay, but there's two parameters. One is how long it takes them to do it, and the other one is whether they do it at all or not. Right. So that's maybe the most interesting thing is whether they open the door or not. If they did it in 2 minutes or in 7 minutes, it's maybe less important, but you can see it's kind of a binary split. Once they learn how to do it, within a couple of minutes, they do it.
But it's amazing, because you say there's some empathy, so they need to see and interact before they open the door.
Right, but it does take a few minutes, but they on subsequent days, they already know, they understand what's going on.
And if there's no rat inside, would they open it?
There's no rat inside, they don't open it. This is what I skipped over here, okay? If there's another rat inside, it is empty. If there's two rats, but the one is that they're separated by a wire mesh, one is with the restrainer, one is without anything. If there's chocolate, they do open it, kind of at the same amount of time. But actually, in more recent studies that we've done, we see that when it's only chocolate and there's no social stimulation, they're not good at learning how to open the restrainer at all, and they usually don't succeed. And there's also strain differences. These cute Sprague-Dawley albino rats are very cute and very motorically challenged, shall we say. And they also don't see almost anything. They're almost blind. So it takes them a long time to learn, but the long Evans rats that you'll see soon, they're much more capable in that sense. So it's not easy for them to open the door. They really have to try a lot. They also don't know in the beginning that it's a door.
Can I ask a question?
Of
in all the trials that you did, all the rats know each other from before? Are they like cage mates?
So
or?
Glad you asked that. because this is what I will be getting to now. It's a big section of the talk. So thank you for asking that. But this is just to give some of the background about the parameters that influence this rescuing or helping behavior that we're seeing. So exactly to your question, we see that rats don't help just anybody. They help their cage mates. They also help strangers from their own strain. Okay. So if there's a Sprague-Dawley inside who they don't know, no problem. They open the door. But if it's a rat from a different strain that they are not familiar with, this black-furred Long Evans strain, no helping occurs. Okay? So this is, you know, when we saw this behavior, it really matches up with our experience as humans, right? There's a huge empathy gap for outgroup members. And the reason that I'm saying outgroup members is because it's not necessarily biologically determined. I will talk about that in a minute. It's a social group. It's a flexible social group. So we tend to empathize a lot more with our in-group members, and we don't really we don't feel the same level of empathy. Even the neural responses to pain and distress of out-group members are really different. For example, the amygdala responses are different. And that it's enough to show somebody a minimal cue for group membership. And even if it's a group that bear, there's bears and eagles, okay? And they show you pictures and faces of strangers, and they say, this is an eagle, this is a bear, your brain responds differently to these strangers. So we're primed to very quickly make decisions about strangers that we meet. Are they friend or foe? We use very small cues and we determine our social behavior. How does that happen in the brain? It's really incredible. Another important point to keep in mind as we plow forward is that despite this very grim state of affairs, there is some hope because we do see a lot of pro-social behavior in humans. We see humans helping others, not of their own group, strangers, sometimes at very high personal cost to themselves, even sacrificing their lives sometimes, right? There's all these anecdotes of people jumping into the road to save a stranger's child, for example. So that hints to us that there might be a different mechanism involved. Maybe there is an automatic, very fast driver for pro-social approach to help others in distress that is based on these evolutionarily conserved circuits for parental care. In the rats as well, they're actually super nice once they have some social experience with rats of the other group. So if they are housed together for 2 weeks with a rat of the other strain, then they will help not only that cage mate from the other strain, they will help strangers from the other strain. They generalize the helping behavior and they become pro-social towards members, towards unfamiliar members of the other strain. Yes?
Do you see an effect in the opposite direction, such that if a rat releases the other, that affects their social behavior?
If a rat what?
If one rat releases another, will that affect their social
That's a really interesting question. I tried to look at it once to check whether the hierarchy dominance, the dominance hierarchy changes. So taking subordinate rats and then seeing whether after helping subordinate rats become dominant, and it does not change the dominance behavior at all. They remain subordinate even after they help. But we think that this is actually a really interesting point. We tend to think of the dominant animals as the assholes, right? Basically, we're like, dominant guy, he's the one who beats up everybody, takes what he wants, right? But actually, that's totally not the case, and there's more and more evidence from different species that dominance comes with a lot of privilege, but it also comes with a lot of social responsibility. And dominant animals actually have a big caretaking role to making sure that others get food and get sheltered. There's researching things from primates to corvids showing that subordinate animals request help more and that there's different roles, functional roles. So that's also something to keep in mind. Anyway, the final bit, the behavioral bit, and then I'm gonna move on to neural stuff, okay? So everyone who thought this was interesting, might find the rest a little boring, and everyone said this is boring, I find the rest more interesting. But the last behavioral tidbit is fostering. So the question was, is there a biological signature for in-group? Is it kinship? Am I helping others because they look like me, because they're the same genetic pool as me, right, Hamilton and all of that? So these rats were fostered at birth. These widespread Dolly albino rats were fostered at birth with the litters of the long-necked strain, and the mother adopts them without any issue. They're very good at that, and they're fostered right after birth. And when they grow up, if helping is determined by genetic relatedness, what would be the prediction? What do you think would be the prediction? When they grow up, they never meet another spread dolly, like Mowgli in the jungle, okay? They're raised with the wolves, they grow up, and they see a little human child in distress. What would they do? If it's genetic, what should they do? Should they help or not help? Who thinks they should help? Who thinks they should not help? Right, so if we are assuming that it's genetically driven, they should help, okay? They should help others even though they mean, maybe the ultimate mechanism, the evolutionary explanation, is kinship, but the proximate mechanism, the biological drivers of this behavior, are different. They're based on social experience, on affective motivation. That's what we're trying to nail down. What do we know from humans? How does empathy work in the brain? Yes.
Sorry, just from before, is there a difference in prosocial behavior between the adult rats and the small children? Like, do adult rats, are they more likely to help the children of other rats that they are have nothing to do with? Or?
Yes, so in generally speaking, that is correct. A rat, I think mice too, I don't know. They're more prosocial towards juveniles, regardless whether they're related to them or not. But we'll get to how juveniles behave a little bit later on. So in the human brain, what happens when you see somebody in distress? Okay, put them in an fMRI, in the MRI, and they measured with fMRI their neural activity. When they see other people, bang. Slamming their finger in a door, cutting their finger with a knife, getting hurt. And what they see is that the same neural network that is activated when you yourself feel pain or distress is the same network that is activated when you see somebody else feel pain or distress. So there's a shared neural network, and that is the neural basis of empathy, how we understand what is happening. But this network involving the insula, anterior cingulate cortex, and other areas, when you actually look at it, is more generally a network that's involved in aversive arousal. Okay, so it's the same network that is activated when you see something disgusting or feel bad. It's the affective component of pain. It's basically aversive arousal network. And it's not enough for me, as a biologist, to understand that level of explanation. I really want to understand what cells are involved in these brain regions. Where are they coming from? Where are they going to? Which neurotransmitters activate them? And how does this stimulus of distress or this distress call initiate this prosocial approach? So to do that, the strategy we use in the lab, the strategy we follow in the lab, basically has two parts. The first part is to create a high-resolution map of neural activity in the brain, okay, kind of like a fake fMRI for rats, by using markers of neural activity, create maps of this neural activity in empathy versus no empathy conditions in this ingroup and outgroup, openers, non-openers. So by contrasting the snapshots of neural activity between these conditions, we can learn which areas are involved and which hubs of this network are critical for this behavior. And you can go and interrogate those hubs instead of having a prerequisite assumption that we should just look at the anterior cingulate cortex or the insula or the amygdala. Okay, I really want to understand the whole circuit. So the first part is descriptive, we want to see it, and the second part is manipulation or functional, where we want to identify those regions of interest and then we want to start manipulating them to understand which parts of the circuit are necessary and sufficient for this behavior, and identify the types of cells that are involved in this behavior. So we use different types of methods for this. For the first type, we use immunohistochemistry, we use tracing experiments, and RNA sequencing, and tagging these active cells, and trying to understand the receptor distribution on these cells. And then we use viral methods and do manipulations or pharmacology, and we also record the calcium imaging from the cells. Okay? And one of the main goals is to turn foe to friend, right? To see if we can manipulate the neural activity in the circuit to actually take these naive rats that don't have social experience with the other strain and make them nice. So far, no One, we see that the same areas in the rats are activated as are in humans. The anterior cingulate cortex and anterior insula were very active in these rats. The weird thing that I did not see coming at all was that these areas, you know, I thought they would be active for the empathy condition and not active for the no empathy condition, but lo and behold, they were active for all the rats who were tested in this paradigm, but not for rats in a billion other control conditions, just like social interaction with the other rat, or brief exposure to the other rat, or baseline conditions, or chocolate condition. So it really seems that the rats, these regions are responding to the fact that there is a trapped rat in distress. They are used to process the fact that there is a trapped rat in distress. Not, however, at all predict whether that rat will help or not. The network that predicts whether the rat will help or not is actually a different network. And it's what we refer to as the reward network in the brain. The dopaminergic reward network, the cortical mesolimbic system is activated only in the ingroup condition. So this is what we find. You can see it here. The regions that are showing up here that are not showing up here are the ones that were only active in the ingroup condition. So you can see that there is quite a range. This is the ACC, this is the insula, some frontal regions, sensory cortex, of course, is more active, and that's really important, actually. When we'll talk about oxytocin, we'll talk about the role of sensory cortex a little bit. So this gives us something to work with. And you know, this red pathway here, the reward system, nucleus accumbens, lateral septum, band of Broca, this network of areas really caught my attention. And we also did a network analysis. Basically, what we are doing here is we are creating a connectivity network that is based off of correlations between the different brain regions. This is not the absolute activity levels. This is which regions were active together or not active together, trying to understand the functional connectivity. So when we look at it this way, we can identify central regions. We use different centrality parameters to see which hubs are central to this network. And in the ingroup condition, we find this network that based off of the connectivity analysis, has a lot of the same regions that we saw before. The nucleus accumbens, lateral septum, anterior insula, prelimbic and frontal areas, and this pointed us more towards this reward and the nucleus accumbens, especially since when we did a huge set of regression analysis, because this is one analysis, but we can change the parameters and test it in different ways. So this is based off of 40 different tests, and the nucleus accumbens, shell and core, came up here very high as occurring only in the ingroup condition as opposed to occurring in both the ingroup and the outgroup condition. Yes?
I was a bit lost.
Looking at you before you raised your hand.
How do you make the graph?
This is a method that I borrowed from Paul Franklin's lab at U Toronto. They published two papers in Neuron and Plus Biology on the fear connect them in the brain where they use this strategy, and I saw it and I really liked it, so I wanted to talk to them, and that I learned it from them. So basically what this is, you create a correlation matrix based off of each row is an animal and each column is a brain region. So you're looking at the correlation between the brain regions that is based off of all these animals. Okay? So, no? So each animal is a row, okay?
Yeah.
And we have how many cells were active, okay, in the nucleus accumbens of the 16 animals in the ingroup condition. And what was the average activity there, okay? So, and then you look at the amygdala and you see what was the activity in the amygdala. And some regions are correlated, okay, and others aren't. And this is the top. You put a certain threshold, in this case it's top 10% correlations, the high highest correlations, the regions that were most correlated, and you create a network graph based on this correlation matrix. And
so it's only positive correlations?
No, it's positive and negative correlations. The negative ones are in Mikuvkar dashed line, but it depends on the way that you define it, which is exactly why I did all of these different tests. But I have to tell you that this network that showed up here, we've been seeing in slight variations again and again over different groups of animals. It keeps coming up, this network. So it, those same regions, the accumbens, the limbic, the medial orbital frontal cortex, the insula, these regions seem to be really connected to the empathy conditions.
Where is empathy in this correlation stuff? So you have different animals?
So in this case, this is the in-group condition. So this is a group of animals that showed helping behavior, and we're comparing it to the functional connectivity of the out-group condition, where there was no helping. So in the out-group condition, we don't see the same cluster. We use a Boolean algorithm for community clustering. These clusters that you're seeing here are generated by the data. They're not. There's no feed of my input into this. It just emerges from the data.
So the outgroup. So you need to take animals from.
From the outgroup.
You only take pair. You always take two pairs of animals.
No, it's only the rats on the outside. It's the rats, the free rats. So if this group has 16 rats that were in the in-group condition and helped, this group had 16 rats of animals that were in the outgroup condition and didn't help. And actually, in those animals, if you look where the nucleus accumbens is, you see that it's right in the middle of a very aversive network here. The periaqueductal gray, the benula, VMH, RM. So, I mean, I wouldn't put too much weight on this finding from a specific group of rats, but this is really interesting because we keep seeing it over and over again. And what it can give us an indication of where we should manipulate with which projections, okay? So which projections, for example, we would be interested in manipulating. So for example, in the neural paper by Paul Franklin, they took this network that they got from fear conditioning, and they started lesioning every central hub and seeing which central hubs stopped the behavior, the fear behavior. And they saw that there are a few, there are not just one, okay? There's a few areas that if you lesion them in this network, you stop the freezing behavior, which makes sense if you think of it as a circuit. It's like an electric circuit, right? You can cut it at different points and you will lose the behavior. So that's the idea behind this type of analysis.
Have you or can you verify the specific nodes? Just as a sanity check that the functional connectome based on the sequences.
Right, so it's to make sure that there is structural connectivity there as
well.
No,
not only structural, I mean, this is more functional, right?
This is a functional, so what
based
we
on the sequence.
Based on the sequence.
So are you thinking of verifying, let's say you find a specific two brain regions
exactly.
are
yes.
highly correlated.
Yes.
Can you or have you verified that other methods that are more direct?
Yes, that's the idea. It's a work in progress. We're just at the tip of the iceberg. So, yeah.
Did you adjust for different modalities? For example, did you control for distress calls and see any difference in the connectome?
We did not monitor in this study for distress calls. I did so in the past, but that's an excellent question, whether it's auditory, visual, factory, multimodal responses. It depends who you ask. We haven't tested it directly. I think it's a multimodal, but there's definitely some papers showing a strong olfactory findings. Some papers looking at visual. Jeff Mogul's papers, they show visual dependencies. But what we do think is that the response to the distress signals, whichever modality they occur in, happen in sensory cortex. They're modulated, the level of the response response is modulated by how salient the signals are. And what determines the saliency of those signals comes very much from oxytonergic influence on interneurons that modulate the signal-to-noise ratio in sensory cortex. Okay, so like if a mother rat hears her baby crying for help, she has very synchronized response in auditory cortex. And that response, the synchrony of that response is caused by oxytonergic input from TDM. And you can stimulate that response by driving optogenetic, that's Rob Fromke's work from NYU, by driving oxytonergic responses optogenetically. But why, like how does oxytocin, what's the connection between, like when you, it's a chicken and egg, right? This is stuff that I'm fascinated by. Like you see somebody, you have to understand, this person is important to me. Now I have a lot of oxytocin, now I will respond to their distress level. Is that how it works? Is it just in auditory cortex? Is there oxytonergic sensitivity throughout this pathway of prosocial response? I believe that there is a sensitivity throughout, even in the nucleus accumbens. There are cells that respond differently, whether the rat on the outside is the in-group or out-group member. And that is changed by experience. They're not born that way. That's from some electrophysiological pilot data that I have. But yeah, I digress. Yeah?
Sorry, just on the previous slide, just wondering how to read the network graph. Is it the size of the node is like the amount of activity and the distance is the connectivity? Or?
No, so the nodes are determined by the R value of the relationship, the degrees. Degrees are the lines that connect, okay? Degrees are determined by the R value. So if CM and anterior insula have R value of 0.8 and they 0.9 and they cross the threshold, then there will be a line there, okay? The size of the circle is determined by how many degrees it has, how connected it is to other region. And there are different measures for centrality, like how many other region, how many times you have to pass through this region to get to other regions in the network. What if you want to get in the shortest path from this one to this one, do you have to go through the nucleus accumbens, for instance? These centrality parameters are used to determine the central regions. You take the top 20% for degree and between us, and that's how it's between us is this how many times you have to cross this to get to other regions. There's a whole world of network graph theory that is behind it. And back to the biological world, what I did here was do calcium imaging, testing calcium signals in the nucleus accumbens while rats were performing the task. And what this gives us is a continuous signal. It's kind of a local field potential. In this case, it's not a miniscope, so we just see the total fluorescence as a proxy for how many cells were firing. And what this gives us is the ability to look within rats across days of testing and also observe in the same rats the response to in-group and out-group members, empty restrainer, all that stuff. And what we did was, what I noticed, I don't know if you'll be able to see it here. What I noticed here is that when the rat pokes his head into the area and the restrainer, there's a peak in the signal, okay? So where the line is the current signal, and there's a signal when he's getting close and poking his head in. And then when he walks away, the signal flattens out, as you'll notice. And even when he's moving around, the signal is flat in the nucleus accumbens. It's not a motor effect. It's a motivational effect that's really and aligned all this, the neural response to this moment that they enter this area. And what we see is a peak in the signal for the in-group rats. This is a strain derived from the same strain, but if it's a different strain, then we don't see this increase in the signal, or if it's an empty restrainer. And interestingly, we see the signal even before they know how to open the door. So it's a motivational response to the social stimulus.
Did you take into consideration the fact that maybe the mice can develop like habituation to the, maybe the, both mice, also the mice that is trapped, maybe is not in distress because he's used to it, or also the mouse outside that he doesn't feel like such empathy because he knows how to do it, or he knows that something's gonna be like.
Let me ask you, okay? If something bad happens to you every day, are you happy at the end?
I hope that I won't be in this situation.
No, they are still stressed at the end. When we measure their stress hormone levels,
yeah, this is why I wanted to ask if you do check the
they are still showing an increase in hormone levels at the end. You know who isn't showing increase in hormone levels? The pairs that learn how to open the door.
Mm-hmm.
They don't show increase. The rats that never learn how to open the door, they're still stressed. The free and the trapped rat, even after the 2 weeks of testing. They are also stressed in the beginning, so we tested all of this. But yeah, I'm just the reviewers keep asking me this question for some reason. Yeah, no, they don't get used to it. They don't like it more a long time, so it's still, but what they do get used to is the fact that there is a rat from another strain in there. And that might have an influence on this neural response that I showed you before. I'm very behind on time from what I wanted to show you to what I'm actually showing. So I'll try to skip some stuff. But back to your question of looking at, I mean, that's how I interpreted your question. What I showed you was a functional connectivity, and now I want to see the structural connectivity, how those projections actually are connected to each other. So we do that with a combination of CFOS and tracing marker. So we do a retrograde tracer called fluorogold, and we inject it into the nucleus accumbens, and what this does, it's basically paints the pathway. And we can identify with this white fluorogold marker all the cells in the brain that project into the nucleus accumbens structurally. Okay, so and then we can do a co-labeling. We can look at the cells that are connected that project, for instance, from the amygdala to the nucleus accumbens and see whether they were CFOS positive, whether they were active during the task or not. Why do we do this? We want to identify the projections that are important, that are going into the nucleus accumbens, that are important for the empathy condition. And what we found in this case, we tested not so many regions, because back then we were still doing this manually, and everything was taking a lot of time, but I will tell you in a minute what we're doing today. We found that from all these regions, there is definitely a bunch of cells that are connected to the nucleus accumbens. But the only region that had a correlation between helping and activity was the anterior cingulate cortex. Okay, so cells going from the anterior cingulate cortex to the nucleus accumbens that were CFOS positive were correlated with how much that animal had helped. It's a nice little finding, it's not huge, but for fortunately or unfortunately for me, a big lab in Stanford that was just published like 1 month before this was published in ELSC, they published a whole paper in Science looking at this specific projection in empathy in mice, empathy for fear and empathy for pain, and they showed that this projection is important in mice in empathy for pain, okay? So I'm feeling more confident in this finding now. I mean, it can't be everything. So thing is, oh, you're, this is not really empathy, you're just looking at rats playing with each other, it's just social reward, even though all the evidence that I showed you, people were just not convinced. So what we're doing now in the lab, since I moved to Israel, the first thing I told my students, okay, we have to move to a separated paradigm, everything that you do is going to be in a separated paradigm. So that's exactly what we've been doing. We've been reproducing all the results in a separated paradigm. And we've been using the long Evans racks this time just because they're much smarter. They get the task faster. It's more difficult this way because they have to push it from the side. It's less ecological for them. It's much more ecological to poke their head in and push it up. And we actually reproducing the same results. They are not helping outgroup members. So this time the spread dollies are inside. They're not helping the spread dollies, but they are helping in-group members. So if you're wondering if they're not opening for out-group members because they're afraid they're going to beat them up or something like that, or threat arousal, possibly, but they're still not doing it even here when there's no chance of getting beat up. And we have also been reproducing this regular paradigm of this strain because it's a different strain. We have to see that everything is the same. Okay, so now, and we've been doing males and females, and we have a big female and male paper in the title for Mona, specifically the gift for Mona. So, so now the idea is to take the neural activity from these rats and try to dissociate this very pure helping without prosocial reward components. So we're doing collaboration with Johannes Kohl in the Crick Institute. Johannes is a relatively new PI there. He was a postdoc with Catherine Dulac. He looks at maternal behavior and in mice, and he's got a very fancy robot that does multiplex RNA scope. So we can look at different probes at the same time on this tissue. And the strategy, again, the same strategy, is to identify CFOS positive cells, but also understand which cells these are. So we're looking right now at probes that are oxytocin receptor probes and dopamine D1 and D2 probes. The first experiment that is being processed right now over there, they already ran all the brains and we're waiting for this data. Because we're really interested in oxytocin, dopamine, serotonin interactions in this context. We also worked a lot on an automated machine, software machine, to do this quantitative analysis for us because I'm very lazy and I don't like things to take a lot of time. Doing them manually is not my cup of tea. So we developed with Ben Kanto, who is a very talented computational student, an automated system that takes these coronal sections of the brain and automatically registers them to the right place in the brain atlas and gives you an output of all the fluorescence in that brain region, all the cells that are positive for whatever fluorescence marker you have at the same time. And now what we're doing is we're validating this automated system against our manual data from before. So I'll let you know how that worked out, or maybe you'll never hear about this again. but it's really gorgeous. I get very, very excited when I look at the stuff that is happening there. And we're really interested in understanding this dopaminergic oxytocinergic interaction. From some preliminary results, when we looked at oxytocin receptors, we saw that they seem to be changed by the task itself, the distribution of oxytocin receptors. And we also see that just by inhibiting dopamine, we block the helping behavior on an immediate day-to-day basis. Like if they're sitting saline, these are rats that know how to help, they help. But if they receive a general dopaminergic antagonist, they don't help as a group, and then back to saline, and they are back to helping. It doesn't say anything about the social contribution here, because maybe they just not motivated, generally speaking. Maybe they wouldn't open their screen for chocolate chips either. But dopamine seems to be, I mean, obviously, involved in this behavior. student this next year. She tried to chemogenetically inhibit this behavior by injecting inhibitory drugs to the nucleus accumbens. And then on the days of testing, systemically injecting CNO, and looking at whether this would stop helping behavior in rats who already know how to open the door. Easy, right? No, the opposite happened. It seems that inhibiting the nucleus accumbens actually facilitated helping behavior. So these rats were openers, but you can see, like, on the saline day before they got the CNO, that's the latency to opening, and then when they get the CNO, it's a very fast opening, and then on the next sailing day, it's a slower opening again. I don't know if this is real yet or what it means. Maybe it's just because we're the CFOS positive cells in the nucleus accumbens are very sparse specific population that we haven't identified yet. What are these cells? And maybe this general inhibition is actually causing an inhibition of the inhibition or something like that, because the nucleus accumbens is mostly made up of inhibitory cells. So we're looking into that. And we also are planning to do some experiments with specific oxytocin receptor virus that we got from Valerie Greenovich, and trying to really look specifically at projections from the ACC to the nucleus accumbens, see whether we can manipulate this behavior. So for right now, we haven't manipulated the behavior yet very convincingly, and we are working on that, but it's a very exciting time in the lab, for sure. And when we do find it, it will be super exciting for everybody who's involved. Last, I will make this last, and I will skip the newer stuff. I will leave something for the next step, so you're with me again. So this is a paper that just got published in iScience, led by Jocelyn Breton, who was my PhD student in Daniela's lab, Daniela Kaffer, who was my mentor at Berkeley, and all the ELF results that I showed were from Berkeley. And so Jocelyn, who was a PhD student there, was leading this experiment, looking at adolescence, back to your question. The idea was to look at the developmental trajectory of prosocial behavior and how that occurs in the brain. We're very interested to understand how rats become prosocial. So that was the motivation. But when we actually ran this experiment and we took adolescents at 30 days, a 30 days old adolescent, and we ran them in the helping behavior, the strangest thing happened. They just helped everybody. They had no bias. They didn't care whether a rat was in-group or out-group, was black or white. They just helped. They were very helpful little adolescent rats. So that was just a striking finding. It very surprised me. And when we looked at the brains of these rats, the major thing that stood out to me, at least, was this light blue area. This is regions that were modulated by group identity. So again, we see very much the same network that we showed before. And these are areas that were manipulated by age, were modulated by age. This is the hippocampus right here. And what you're seeing here is that it was much more active in the adults than it was in the adolescents, okay? So the adolescents had more activity in the red areas, which is the reward network, the nucleus accumbens too, but also in frontal areas, specifically the ventral orbital frontal cortex. And when we looked at all these areas in the hippocampus very carefully, specifically the CA2 stood out. It was the only region that was more active here, but was not active for group identity. So it seems that the CA2 specifically is determined, is somehow special for this task. And of course, there is a lot of background in the literature on CA2 and social memory and social recognition. So now we are trying to look at the connections between CA2 and these other regions that we're looking at before, and trying to understand how this group categorization is formed in the adults, and how that makes them racist, basically. Okay, so I was kidding. I didn't talk about Reut's project or Esterina's project, but Esterina is looking at how helping increases physical and emotional health of the rats that are helping. And we look at immune system activity, we do analysis of the peripheral immunity and genes in the brain that are changing. And Reut is focusing, she's also working on early life stress, but she's more focusing on the difference between